Good morning. Lodewijk sent me a question on the internet. What cameras I use when I are on the bike out there, and how do I have mounted these cameras on the bike? If I start editing, how I exactly do that? So this is some kind of an explanation how I manage that. First, there is a GoPro Max 360 that is mounted on the steer on the left mirror on a pole that is pointing forward almost horizontally. The camera must be mounted in a straight line with the pole, because then the camera software is able to render the pole out of the footage, making it look if the pole doesn't exist at all. I mounted the pole horizontally because then afterwards in the editing software I can make it look if the camera is floating in front of the bike. Because it is a 360 camera, it films with two lenses, one at the front and one at the rear, where the software glues the footages together, making it look like if the camera has filmed 360 degrees around. Now what you see here is the software that the editing software that comes with the GoPro. And I have a footage here that looks like a little bit that the camera, the GoPro, is floating in front of me. And I can zoom out further and still further and still further and still further. And now it becomes very weird, because now it is some kind of a 360 picture, and well, it's possible to do that, but I don't like it, to be honest. So if I zoom in a little bit further and I drag it, then I don't have that not much of a disturbance of the picture. It looks like a little bit normal. But the fun thing here is that I can move it around. Now a little bit from the side, and I can turn it completely up front, and then I can see everything that is in front of the camera, right? And still I can drag it to the left. Now I have a lot of disturbance again, because the road is bending sort of. Well, it's not in real life, but here it looks like a little bit it's bending. But going further and going further, then I see myself again. And the pole the camera is mounted on is not visible here. It's here on the left mirror, but you see that it's almost rendered out of the picture, which is quite awesome. I can zoom in a little bit further. No, you cannot. No, the pole is almost not visible here. This, so this is very good. And I, yeah, can look upwards to the sky, and I can look downwards to the road itself. Now, the second thing is that this file is a so-called 360 file, and a 360 file is in itself not usable, so you need to render an MP4 format out of it, and then you get a movie that you can use everywhere. So how to do that? And this software, in this editing software, you see below a timeline coming up, and by dragging the timeline I can move the footage, the film, a little bit forward or backward. So let's say that this is fine for now. I have to click on the top, this icon over there. I click it, and now you see at the timeline things coming up. I already had edited for the movie I did the last weekend in Epe, but here, to do it again, I can click now on this blue dot, and then I can say from this point on I'm going to drag the movie a little bit to the left, right? So, and I click again on that blue dot, and then I drag it, the timeline, a little bit forward, and let's say that I want to look down and click it again. Then I have three points put on the timeline with some camera movies, camera angles. So then I drag it back, and then I click the scissors here, and I then click on the blue scissor, drag the timeline to the end of the third
pointer, click the scissor again, and now I have some kind of a footage selected of, what is it? I think it's 1 minute. So if I now drag it back and I play it, then you can see what is happening now, because the switches I have put on the timeline, I'm going to move around. Where is it? No, not yet. It's coming up. Probably I did something wrong here, because I want to do some other angle. Oh yeah, it's now turning down a little bit. That's what I've done. Yeah, it's looking now to the road in itself. Okay. But the idea is clear. By playing with the timeline and putting markers on the timeline, and then with the scissors make a cutout of the extract you want to create, what you want to render, then I can click on the export button over there. And if I do that, I can change some settings about quality and so forth. And then when I press next, it asks me where to put the rendered video, and that gives me a .movie extension file, and that's a kind of file I can use everywhere to put it on YouTube or whatever. The DJI action camera is mounted on a chin mount that I have bought on the internet. It comes from Canada, I believe. It is glued on the chin piece of the helmet, and then you are able to mount a GoPro camera adapter on it, on which you can attach the DJI camera. An advantage of DJI cameras is that they are also having a strong magnet next to the clamp that makes mounting very easy. GoPros only have a cumbersome fork as a mounting device. All action cameras do have stabilization software that prohibits video footage from shaking around. Inside the helmet chin piece, I have put a small lavalier microphone that is attached to the DJI camera via a Rode AI Macro interface, which enhances the sound quality. By putting a microphone inside the helmet, you avoid recording most of the wind noise. And I use duct tape to fit everything in the chin piece. And I do have the same DJI camera on the back, on a top case. And I completely agree with you that this is not very sophisticated. It works and it films. I used some simple duct tape to make sure I'm not losing it on the way, because the suck cup is not very sucking. It sucks, actually.
Okay, that's about cameras on the bike, but I do also have something else, which is a drone, and that's something awesome. I have no other words for it. Beautiful. I am not going to give you information about the drone itself. On YouTube you can find hundreds of videos from other people explaining everything you might think of. I need to say the drone have really amazed me about its features and possibilities. Yes, it costs a couple of bucks, but considering all the technology that one have put into it, I consider it worth every penny. Today I tried something that I didn't do in April last weekend. It's called active tracking. For that I wanted to have a quiet land road without being disturbed by traffic and without poles or trees or whatsoever, to avoid taking any risks. What you see here is called parallel tracking, but there are also other possibilities in where the drone is flying around me or behind me. But first I wanted to make myself better familiar with it. As you can see, it works fantastically. I drove about 35 kilometers an hour here, but the drone can follow around 50 kilometers an hour also.
Finally, I landed the drone by hand instead of using the so-called automated return to home option, which is also present. To be able to use active tracking while driving, I needed to mount the controller on the steer of the bike, because the controller contains a touchscreen, so launching the drone and then tuck the controller away is not possible, because then the screen is touched in ways you do not want to happen. But having the controller on the steer together with all the other stuff that is present, like a Garmin and also a mobile phone, makes it look like the cockpit of an aeroplane. And finally, when you do have all that footage, then it becomes a question how to make a nice movie out of it. Well, that's mostly about throwing things away. You have a lot of footage and it needs to be edited, it needs to be cut, it needs to be combined. And I do that with Filmora software. And you should have in mind that what if you want to have a movie of around 30 minutes, 40 minutes, it will take a full day of throwing things away, and makes it nicely to look at, and that's quite a lot of time. But to me, I consider it as another hobby, to be honest. So after riding a bike, next thing is how to make a nice movie out of it. Well, that's real fun. Thank you for watching.